Can tiggers climb trees better than poo?
Climbing trees is what they do best.
Ooh, could they climb that one?
They're always climbing trees like that. I'll show you. Up we go!
Whee!
I always said tiggers could climb trees. Not that it's easy, mind you. Of course, there's the coming down to do. Backwards. Whoop!
Ooh, Tigger, are we at the top?
What? No.
Are we going to the top?
Oh, no.
Look, Pooh. There's something in one of those pine trees.
It's a jaguar. They hide in trees and drop on you when you go underneath. Christopher Robin told me.
Hmm.
Help! Help!
That's what jaguars always do. They call, help, help, and then when you look up, they drop on you.
Pooh and Piglet, Pooh and Piglet.
I believe it's Tigger and Roo.
Hello, Pooh.
Oh, Christopher Robin, Tigger and Roo are up in a pine tree and can't get down. If only you were here, we could think of something to do.
Well, I guess I could take off my jacket, and then Tigger and Roo could jump into it.
You remember how brave you were, my boy. Your friends were all very proud of you for your cleverness. Pooh, most of all. He was very proud of you.
Was I proud, too?
Oh, yes, Christopher Robin. You were very, very proud.
I'm gonna give a party.
You are? Are you?
And it's to be a special sort of party, because it's because of what Pooh did when he did what he did to save Piglet from the flood.
Oh, that's what it's for, is it?
Yes. So will you tell Pooh as quickly as you can, and all of the others?
Pooh, Christopher Robin is giving a party.
Oh, will there be those little cake things with pink sugar icing?
Well, I'm not certain, but Christopher Robin told me to relate to you that it is a special sort of party because it is because of what Pooh did when he did what he did to save Piglet from the flood. A sentence which is curiously reminiscent in form of 17th century French poetry, for, as anyone knows, all French poetry from that period is redundantly repetitive. Well then, I said, oh, that's what it's for, is it? Then he said, yes, so I came and told you. Now I must take my leave to tell the others. Goodbye.
A party for me. How grand.
I want you all to know that we're celebrating a very special person today, and some very great things that he has done. And I want to give him this to show my appreciation. Where is it?
I'd just like to thank you all for coming out here today. I'd just like to say that what I did wasn't anything any of you would have done in the same situation. Well, except for you, and you, and Pooh, but, you know, he doesn't really count. And I'm entirely undeserving of whatever he's got over there.
Here you go, Pooh.
Oh, great. Pencils. How splendid.
Thank you. Hey, Christopher Robin, what do you got there?
Winnie the Pooh.
A stuffed animal, huh? He's not a stuffed animal. He's a real bear.
Yeah, right.
I'll prove it. Park, Pooh. Park.
There is some hope for you, Mr. Mel.
Science is finally finding solutions for reoccurring dreams such as yours.
But they're not dreams, though it is difficult to say which came first. Did I do something, and did my father then write a story around it? Or was it the other way about? Did the story come first? Certainly my father was on the lookout for ideas, but so was I. He wanted them for his stories, I wanted them for my games, and we each looked towards the other for inspiration. But in the end, it was all the same. The stories became a part of our lives. We lived them, thought them, spoke them.
However, from the events that you have related, these stories still give the impression of a reoccurring dream. Now, I have had many cases exactly like this one, and I know a reoccurring dream when I hear about it. I once had an aunt, well, a great aunt, really. She had problems with reoccurring nightmares. She lived in Cobblestone most of her life, but when she was 50, she moved to southern France because she liked the flowers. One day, when she was visiting some friends at their home, well, it was a wine shop, actually. They owned the wine shop and lived above it.